Good morning, church. Oh, it's good to see you. Thank you, Dan. That's beautiful. Everybody stand up. Oh, I know it's hot outside, but the Spirit of the Lord is warmer, and He's cool. I can't prove that by Scripture, but I think it's true. If you clicked in this morning, we're so glad you're here. We're going to worship with our whole hearts today. Give ourselves to praise. Ready? Here we go. This is the song for the hurting. I hope that it helps you to heal. This is the song when the worst of the worst is all you can feel. This is a song for the lonely. If you've lost someone you can't live without, a song for the souls that are searching and hearts that are broken down. Sing with me now. Sing with me now. Hallelujah.
Greenville Oaks. Oh, we can do better than that. Good morning, Greenville Oaks. There we go. So glad you're here with us this morning. Those of you here in the room, we're glad you're here. And again, a welcome to those that are watching online. I know many of you are joining us through technology, and we're so glad that you're able to watch us on whatever platform it is that you are watching us. And we want you to know that we consider you a part of our community of faith and our church family here. And when you're ever in the area, come and join us in person. But we're thankful that you're able to be here with us this morning. Glad everyone is here. We are a church inspiring people to follow Jesus each and every day, and we invite you on that journey with us. Please join. Whether you are a member of this church or you are a first-time guest, know that you are invited on this journey with us as we truly seek to follow Jesus Christ in all that we do. I've got several announcements, so bear with me this morning, and then we'll continue on in our worship. First of all, a couple things. We are very excited. Today's a very special day. We get to welcome the Becks. The whole Beck family is here, Jenny and Caleb and their kids. Jenny and Caleb have been, welcome them, please. Yes, welcome them. They have been missionaries and in relationship and part of our church family for 13 years now, I think Jenny told me. And they're now in North Africa doing great work and helping support ministries and missionaries that are working with refugees and immigrants. And they're going to share a little bit more about the work that they do, but they're an incredible blessing to our church and to the kingdom of God. And thank you guys for all that you do, and we're so glad you're here. And they're going to be around the North Texas area for a few weeks, and we'll have them back in a couple weeks for a special event, and you'll hear more about that. But glad you're here. They're going to share with us in just a little bit. Next Sunday, June the 19th, is Father's Day. So please come back, bring Dad, come back and join us in a celebration of our dads and of the incredible men who are such blessings and gifts in our life. And we're going to celebrate them. Our family ministry, our children's ministry have some special activities planned to celebrate our dads. So make sure you come back next Sunday and join us for that. Also, we've got another community initiative. We want to continue to be a church that is for Collin County, and we invite you to fill a bag and feed a child. And over here in the Faith at Home Center, we've got bags here. One of the things that we have come to recognize as part of a collaborative, cooperative effort of churches here in the Allen area and beyond the city of Allen is that there are kids, especially in Title I schools and in certain demographic areas of our community, that they are part of lunch programs through the schools. And so during the school year, they get fed breakfast and lunch, but not during the summertime. And there's a gap there that we are going to step in along with other churches here in the area to help fill that. And so we've been tasked with filling 100 bags. These bags will help feed a child for a week. And so we have 100 bags that we have sitting out here. Some were taken at first service. If there's any left over, please go and grab them. There's a list of specific items and the amount and quantity of that item that we need to put in that bag. And so I want to challenge you to take a bag, go fill it up, bring it back over the next couple of weeks, and help us go and feed these kids throughout Allen and beyond our community that are in need this summer. So it's a great reminder and an opportunity for us to continue being that church that is for Collin County. Fill a bag, feed a child. Please make sure you stop by the Faith at Home Center and do that today. Also, today is a very special day because we are launching into our elder selection process. You've heard me talk about this over the last few weeks, but it is a time now that we listen to the prompting and the guidance of God and who He will call out as the next group of elders of this church. We are so blessed by the men and their wives that serve in helping shepherd and lead this church. What an incredible group we have, and what a gift they are to our church. Incredible leaders. And we look forward to them continuing to serve, but we want to add to that, continue to grow the shepherds, continue to grow the base of leadership here at our church. And so we're entering into this process. Normally it's every couple years. Due to COVID, we were a little behind scheduling doing that, but we're now ready to launch the next elder selection process. So here's the challenge for us all. And that is, I want to challenge you to be a part of this process. I want to challenge you to give it the time, the prayer, the thought, the intentionality of being a part of it. In the past, we have not always had as good a participation as I think we're capable of. Somewhere around 25% of our church has participated in this process. This is a very important thing that we do in the life cycle of our church, and that is to listen to the calling out that God has placed before us and the next elders of this church. So I want to challenge you to be a part of it. I want to challenge you today to begin praying about it, if you haven't been praying about it, to begin thinking about it. Whether you have one name that you would like to put forth as a nomination, or you've got 30 or something in between, it doesn't matter to me. It is that you recognize the responsibility and the opportunity that you have as members of this church to participate in this process, that God's going to speak through and to each of us in helping us understand who the next group of leaders will be. So please be a part of the process. Here's what's going to happen. You've got to be a part of the My Greenville Oaks, okay? So if you are not a part of My Greenville Oaks, the first thing you need to do is you need to get signed up with My Greenville Oaks. That's our church database that you're able to go and access all the information about our church as a member of this church. If you are not a part of My Greenville Oaks, if you don't have access to it or utilize it, you need to get in touch with Michelle Rainey in the church office. Email her, call her. You need to do that first, okay? Please get signed up and be a part of My Greenville Oaks. Everything's going to be online. We want to make this as easy as we possibly can. Whether you are here in town or not, you do not have to be present to participate. We just need you to be a part of this church and connect it through My Greenville Oaks. So if you aren't, get in touch with Michelle Rainey, and she will help you get your My Greenville Oaks account set up so that you can access the nomination forms, the confirmation forms, the process forms, everything that's going to be happening over the next several months of this process. It's all going to be happening through My Greenville Oaks. There's three men that we have asked to serve as overseers of this process: Tim Barrick, John Rainey, and Jake Sanders. Those three men, if you do not know them, you're going to get to know them over the next several months, but they're going to be the three who will be handling all the processing of the nominations, all the compiling of information and data over the next few months as we go through this. It's intentionally not an elder or not a staff person, so we've asked three men from our church to serve, and so we're grateful for John and Tim and Jake's willingness to help lead this process as we move forward. Please be a part of this process. Please get signed up. Please be intentional about your participation in it. And the final thing I want to ask you to do is this Wednesday, June the 15th, we're going to have a day of prayer and fasting as we launch this process. We truly want to ask God to lead us in identifying who the next elders of this church will be. So if you're able to participate fully throughout the day or only for certain times during the day, whatever works for you, whatever's comfortable and safe for you as far as your health goes, but we invite you to give up something during the day and dedicate that time to prayer and intentionality and focused efforts on listening to God as He guides us through this process. And I'm going to close this time with a prayer, and then we'll continue on in our worship this morning. But please, please, be a part of the next elder selection process. Let's pray. Father, we invite you into this moment, to this time in the cycle of life in our church. And God, I pray that you will clearly reveal to us the names that you already have and you already know. Father, as we look to see who will be leading us in the future, Father, please clearly identify, call out those with boldness and courage, compassion, humility, servanthood, love, for you and your church. Father, make it clear to us who they are. May this process go smoothly, but may it be accordance to your will. Father, may we set our own desires and thoughts and wants and hopes and wishes aside and truly trust your will and your plan for this process as we look to the future here at Greenville Oaks. Father, we love you. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Amen. Again, we're so glad you're here this morning. Stand back up and let's continue our worship this morning.
Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. Hearts who are content, and all
That's because this is Shane Spencer's last time to sing with us. They're moving to East Texas. And it just so happened that both Whitney and Sarah were unavailable this weekend. And so Shane's mom came and sang back up for us. Yeah. I'm going to miss this guy. There's nobody quite like Shane Spencer. If you know him, he's iconic. Thank you for doing what you just did. For being faithful in shouting from the mountains. You are a great servant of the Lord, and I thank you. It's been a pleasure to serve with you. One of the reasons, yeah. When we gathered for our prayer up here, I said, Shane, are you going to be emotional today? And he said, no, man, I'm an oak. Well, a big limb of an oak tree just fell off, so there you go. I love him dearly. The reason I picked that song to precede communion is, number one, I think it's one of the most splendid examples of the gift that God has given Shane in his voice and in his honest communication of the love of God. But the bridge in that song is spectacular in my mind. Shout it. Go on and scream it from the mountains, right? That he is God. And the couple that I want to introduce to you now, Caleb and Jenny Beck, are doing that, as all of us should be. They are proclaiming the love of God in some of the toughest parts of the world. So we are honored, we're privileged, we're blessed this morning. As tears roll down my face, to have Jenny and Caleb come and share their communion thoughts with us. So please listen to what they have to say.
Yeah, that's kind of hard to follow. But it is truly an honor to be here this morning.
Just whenever we started with Greenville Oaks, like 13 years ago, one of the first people we met was your wife. It was on a short mission trip to Grenada, and anyway, she was spectacular. I don't know if she's here, but she's spectacular, so we're sorry to hear that. Blessings as you go. We are so happy to be here this morning. Every time we come back into this building, we see faces that have been here every time we're here over years, and there's always new faces, but it feels like family every time that we come back, and so it's always an incredible blessing for us to be here, and we're grateful to be on the stage today, bringing forth some of these thoughts for the communion today. So,
and we just got back in the States a week ago and spent a week in Midland, where my brother flew down from Wisconsin and my sister, and they both have new babies, and we got to spend a time, kind of a family reunion, which we don't get to do very often because we live kind of far away, and it was really sweet. And I think for communion today, just as we were thinking, and this morning too, as we gather as a family and stand on the stage and share some tears, and I shared some of those with you, Shane, that just the recognition that we are one huge, awesome, global family, and we feel honored. We got to sit at tables in Rwanda for 13 years and walk with people through some hard things as they tried to process and recover from genocide. And you guys have brothers and sisters in Rwanda because of it. And now God has invited us into a whole new part of the world. It's in North Africa. And we're learning, and we're still learning a lot. And we get to sit at new tables with new brothers and sisters. And I think this communion thing that we do, where we take this little piece of bread and this, you know, a little cup of wine. Guys, all over the world, people are doing this. The place we're in now, people give up a lot to be able to share in this communion. They give up family. They give up so much. We've just been so impressed by that. And just want you to know that our family is not just this. That our family, that this family reunion, this table that we come and gather to, spans races, it transcends nationalities. It transcends rich and poor and Jew and Gentile and white and black and all colors, guys. And it is one awesome family, and it is one awesome honor to be able to share it with you guys this morning. So I just want to read a little word over you this morning and remind us what family that we're actually a part of.
All right, so this is out of Isaiah 43. It says, "Do not fear, for I am with you. I will bring you your offspring from the east, and from the west I will gather you. And I will say to the north, give them up. And I will say to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from far away and my daughters from the end of the earth. And bring forth the people who are blind yet have eyes, and who are deaf yet have ears. Let all the nations gather together, and let all the peoples assemble, and let them hear and say, it is true."
Pray with me. Father, we just say we thank you so much for coming to us as one of us, and for opening a way for us to be family, for us to share at a table, Lord, that there is no barriers, and that all of the dividing walls of hostility have been torn down. I say thank you for that, Lord. Say thank you for Jesus. Thank you for this family as well, Lord. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Our communion meal, let's stand together again and share in this song. God is the one who tells us who we are, and God uses shepherds among us to help shape us into the kinds of people we need to be and to care for us when we stumble. And this song speaks to that well. Let's sing out.
I feel like I'm a nobody, wonder if I'll ever amount to much. Seems like no matter what I do, it's never gonna be good enough. Should I just give up? Lord, I need to hear you speak. Tell me
I am loved. Tell me I am known that you died for me. I am not alone. You tell me I'm your child. When your heart beats for, I will find my strength, knowing I am yours. You've always known what my heart needs, and you tell
instant applauders. We know that it's not going to us, it goes to the Lord. God be praised. Y'all have a seat, and if you are age 3 to grade 5, this is your opportunity to go to children's worship. If you're a guest with us, this may be your first time, and you have children in that bracket, you're welcome to go with them as well and see what our children's worship and our children's ministry is all about. All right. Lord bless you and keep you. Here comes Wade.
Hello. It's good to see everyone gathered here today. It's also good for us here to know that we're being seen by all of our friends who are watching online, and we're glad that we can all be together in this way. If you have your Bibles, please turn to 1 Peter chapter 5, and I will begin reading in verse 1. Peter says, "To the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder and a witness of Christ's sufferings, who also will share in the glory to be revealed. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, watching over them, not because you must, but because you're willing, as God wants you to be, not pursuing dishonest gain, but eager to serve, not lording over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. And in the same way, you who are younger, submit yourselves to the elders. And all of you, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another, because God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble." This seems like an appropriate passage to read as we kick off our elder shepherd selection process, as it helps focus our thoughts on the nature of Christian leadership, especially how Christian leadership is different from all other forms of leadership. I hope today, as you hear me talk about Christian leadership, what you hear me say will apply not just to those among us who are known as elders or shepherds of our congregation, but to all of us who are or who aspire to be in any form of Christian leadership. That could include leading a group or teaching a class or coordinating a ministry or volunteering in children's ministry or student ministry or even simply mentoring another Christian. One leadership guru has famously said, all leadership really is influence. If you have influence over any other person, then you are a leader. You may be a leader of one, you may be a leader of some, you may be a leader of many. All of us have the opportunity as followers of Christ to exercise some influence over someone else, which means we all are called on some level to be leaders. And so I hope that what you hear me say today, you will be able to apply it to your own leadership journey. Now, having said that, it is clear in the passage that we just read that Peter is talking to some specific people in the congregations that he's writing to, these house churches, and he uses two terms to address them. Two different terms, they're related, and really they're equal and the same, but just different ways of saying it. The first term, he addresses the elders. Well, elders means those who are older. That's the literal meaning. The elders are the older ones, but it's also those who are given the task and the responsibility of overseeing the life of a congregation. And the connection between age and authority, was much stronger in the ancient world than it is today. So that the olders are qualified to be the elders because of their wisdom and experience and because they have been walking the path longer than the youngers have. And so it makes sense that Peter could call the youngers to honor and respect and submit to the elders. Now, keep in mind, though, that in the Roman Empire, the average life expectancy was 25. And if you made it all the way to 50, you were considered old. So it's relative, culture by culture. Now that's the first term. Second term he uses are shepherds. Shepherds, that was a common designation for leaders in the Judeo-Christian story. The Lord is called shepherd in Psalm 23. David, the writer of Psalm 23, greatest king in Israel, was before he was a king, he was a shepherd. Jesus in the Gospel of John describes himself as the good shepherd. Peter, in the passage we read, describes Jesus as the chief shepherd. Peter describes himself as a shepherd. And shepherds have a primary responsibility, and that is to oversee a flock. And that includes feeding it, protecting it from harm or danger, as well as going out and rounding up the lost or stray sheep who wander away from the fold. One of the challenges we face when we read a passage like this and others like it that talk about shepherding in the scriptures, as modern suburban Christians, is that we are far removed from the everyday world of shepherding. Everything I know about shepherding, I learned not on the farm, not in the field, not in the pasture. I learned from reading my Bible and from listening to sermons about shepherds in church when a church is kicking off an elder selection process. So I was fascinated when several years ago I stumbled on an online article in Modern Farmer magazine, on the Modern Farmer website. That's right, modern farmers have their very own website. And this article was written by a modern-day shepherd who was sharing the lessons he had learned from taking care of his lambs. Now, this is not written from a Christian or spiritual perspective. This guy is a real-life shepherd who is taking care of a real flock of lambs. And he says, these are the lessons I've learned from my lifetime of being a shepherd. And I read this article online and I couldn't help but think like a preacher and think, I wonder if I could fit that in a sermon someday. Surely some of what he shares in this article will apply to Christian leadership. And it does. In fact, it's easy to apply. For example, the first lesson he shares is that a shepherd's life is most humble. And he talks about in the article how in the ancient world, being a shepherd was one of the lowliest tasks that anyone could be asked or forced to perform. It's still true in a number of places around the world today. In fact, modern-day shepherds, he says, don't like to be called shepherds because of the low association. They would rather be called ranchers or flock owners. Shepherd, for those who really live in the shepherding world, it's not an honorific title. Someone who's called shepherd is given a humble task to perform and would be seen just a little above a household slave in the ancient world. In verse 5, after Peter tells the youngers to submit to the elders, he says to everyone, to the elders and the youngers, to the shepherds and the sheep, to the leaders and the followers, he says, all of you, clothe yourselves in humility toward one another. Everybody is to be humble toward one another in the Christian community. There's no looking down on one another in the Christian community. We're all clothed in humility. And the word he uses for clothe is a form of the word used to describe in the original language the apron of a household slave. And it also brings to mind Jesus wrapping a towel around his waist just before he washes his disciples' feet. In the Christian community, both leaders and followers are clothed in humility. And this is Christianity's, one of its most unique contributions to the philosophy of leadership. Because in the ancient Greco-Roman world, humility was not a virtue. It's become a virtue in our world because of Christianity. In the ancient world, humility was not a virtue, it was a liability. It was a sign of shame or weakness. One did not One did not receive credit for being humble. And it's only after the example of Christ and the Christian community that humility is held up and showcased as an essential characteristic of leadership. Servant leadership, it's almost cliche now in modern leadership literature, servant leadership. 2,000 years ago, when Jesus taught his followers to lead by assuming the posture and the position of a humble slave or servant, it was revolutionary. It changed the shape of leadership in the Western world forever. So to be a shepherd is to be called to a humble servant's task, not a position of power, a position of service. Second lesson, he says, you know what? Sheep are smarter than you think they are. And he has to say this because people in the non-shepherding or the non-sheep world stereotypically describe sheep as the dumbest animals in the world. And how do we know they're the dumbest animals in the world? Well, because they have to have a shepherd in order to survive. But this guy in this article, he says, any true shepherd would tell you they know the truth about sheep and they are smarter than you think they are. The shepherd learns something from his sheep. It's also true in the Christian community. The shepherd and the sheep are always learning from one another. The leader and the follower are both clothed in humility. We don't look down on each other or anyone else. Years ago, David Ray, one of my professors in college and one of the best shepherds I've ever known, he said in class one day, he said, one of my core beliefs is that everyone I meet is my teacher. He said he believed that every person he encountered had something to teach him, and so he approached every interaction, every relationship, every encounter as a learner, not just a teacher. David Ray is 6'9" tall. He never looks down on anyone because he believes everyone is his teacher. One of the lessons I've learned from being a preacher over the years is that I learn far more from the churches I work with about how to live the Christian life than I ever teach. My expectation is I'm going to learn far more about following Jesus from you than you are ever going to learn from me. Sheep are smarter than you think they are. Third, he says, tend the flock, but care for the individual. What is a flock? A flock is a collective of individual sheep with different strengths and weaknesses and personalities and needs. And it's easy to lose sight of the individual sheep when tending the flock. And he says in the article that the more you take care of the individual sheep, especially those who are in trouble, the healthier the flock is overall. Jesus said in Luke 15, a good shepherd goes after that one lost sheep, because every sheep matters. The flock is not complete as long as there's one sheep missing. So take care of the flock, but also tend the individuals. Take care of the individual. Number four, he says the joy of birth never gets old, and sometimes it's not easy. And watching a new birth in the Christian community, witnessing a baptism, it never gets old. Never gets old, but then walking alongside a new believer as they leave behind their old way of life and lean into their new identity in Christ, which means breaking sinful habits and letting go of destructive patterns of behavior, that can be one of the hardest and sometimes most heartbreaking aspects of Christian leadership. Oh, it's great to see new life, but it's not always easy. And then he says, cute doesn't last forever. That's number five. That's self-explanatory. And if it's not, just go watch season one of Stranger Things and compare the child actors from season one with the so-called child actors of season four. They're not cute anymore. Number six, nothing is more picturesque and serene than sheep grazing on a beautiful hillside. There is an ideal vision of what a flock is and what the relationship between a shepherd and the sheep and what life with that flock is supposed to be. There's this idyllic moment that is glorious. And in the same way, there are these moments in a congregation, sometimes worship gathering like this, or in a prayer huddle, or when there's a private act of forgiveness and reconciliation between two people who have been at odds. There are these moments that shepherds get to witness that are absolutely glorious. It's the ideal of what church is supposed to be like, what Christianity can be like, and it's what makes saying yes to the role of shepherd or coordinating a group or leading a ministry worth it. You get these glimpses of what it's really supposed to be like. Number seven, he says a good dog is more than just a great friend. Now, admittedly, at first I wasn't sure how I was going to apply this. But then I read what he said about his dog. And he described his relationship with his dog as a partnership. He says, I could not do my job without my dog. My dog performs essential shepherding responsibilities and tasks. And I thought, oh yeah, of course, I know, of course. Shepherding is a team sport. Christian leadership is a team sport. No one person is equipped to lead or guide or help all different kinds of peoples and personalities. No one person can be all things to all people. We need a team of shepherds. It's the wisdom of having a plurality or a team of elders leading and overseeing a congregation. They not only share the responsibility and the load, but they also make up for each other's weaknesses and blind spots. It's a team sport. In lesson number eight, he says that death on a farm is inevitable. Death on a farm is inevitable. Sometimes shepherds lead their sheep through the valley of the shadow of death. There's no going around it. You have to go through it. And Christian leadership involves walking alongside others in some of the darkest, most difficult moments of their lives. And I must admit, this is the part of Christian leadership I struggle with the most. It is not easy for me to sit with others in their pain or to be a source of comfort when they're suffering. I have to work at it, and I never feel like I'm measuring up. But again, that's another reason I'm glad I serve on a team where there are others who are better at this than I am. So once again, leadership, shepherding, it's a team sport. So those are the first eight lessons. It's pretty good stuff, isn't it? Pretty much preaches on its own, doesn't it? Lesson nine. Happy lambs are tastier lambs. Wait, what? Hold on, it gets worse. Nothing makes a party like a whole lamb on a spit. My sermon just fell apart. Oh, what? This guy's a modern-day shepherd, and he owns a business. And his singular purpose for running that business and raising and feeding and taking care of these little lambs is to sell them to restaurants and caterers for a profit. But even these last two lessons illustrate the unique nature of Christian leadership, because it's different. Christian shepherds are different. This is how Jesus describes himself as a shepherd in John 10:11. He said, I am the good shepherd. You may know some bad shepherds. You may know some shepherds that raise tasty lambs, but I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. And then Peter, back in 1 Peter chapter 2, he talks about the good shepherd who lays down his life and the impact and the function of that death on a cross. Saying in verse 25, he said, for you were like sheep going astray, but now you have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. Peter says it is the good shepherd's act of laying down his life for the sheep that draws the wayward sheep back into the fold. It's the chief shepherd's sacrifice that calls the sheep home. And he holds up this example of the chief shepherd laying down his life as an example for those he calls elders and shepherds in a church, that they are to follow the chief shepherd's example. Not shepherding out of selfish interests or a hope for personal gain. They're to set aside their ego and to follow Jesus' example. Humble, sacrificial service for the flock. One of the details in this passage in 1 Peter 5 that I find striking is how much time Peter spends talking to the elders and the shepherds. He spends several verses talking to the leaders, and then he devotes only a few words to the youngers. He says, yeah, and submit to your elders. But he spends far more time talking to the leaders of the congregation than he does the followers in the congregation. And sure, there's always the possibility that a rebellious younger will refuse to submit to an elder. But Peter seems to think that if the elders are focused on their task of shepherding in the way of Christ, laying down their lives in humility for the sheep in the way of Christ, Peter seems to think if shepherds are leading that way with humble service, submission isn't going to be much of a problem. Submission's not going to be much of a problem for the sheep who will follow the good, the sacrificial, the laying down my life for your sake, shepherd. It's one of the fundamental challenges of Christian leadership. Whether you call yourself an elder or a shepherd, or you just have some influence over a small group of people or one other person, one of the fundamental challenges of Christian leadership is not convincing or cajoling or guilt-tripping our sheep to follow us. It is focusing on becoming more like Jesus so that we as leaders are more followable. The New Testament has very little to say about leadership. Jesus did not spend a lot of time in his ministry talking about how to be a better leader. He didn't put on very many leadership seminars. But he did spend some time talking about how to be a follower, which it turns out is the secret to good Christian leadership. The mark of a good Christian leader is how well do you follow? Because the leaders who are most followable and the shepherds who are most trustworthy are those who are following the chief shepherd most faithfully. So may we as leaders, as people of influence, may we draw near to our chief shepherd. And may we learn from his example of humility as we set an example for those who are following us. Let's close by standing and reading out loud together the Lord's Prayer. Let's read it as we have the last several. Let's read this with boldness. Let's read this with passion, believing that we have a good Father in heaven and we also have a good shepherd who is seeing after our needs and taking care of us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Go in peace. Have a great week.